So one of the key principles that we like to teach families is we call it state dependence. And really what that means is that different parts of the brain are going to be activated and on when you're in one state versus another state. So let's just talk about what we mean by state. So the two state basically is referring to sort of this, the internal condition of the brain and the body. And so there's the state of wakefulness when you're awake. Certain parts of your body and brain are doing things. And when you're asleep, that's another state. Different parts of your brain and body are doing things. And the point is that what parts of your brain are activated will change depending upon what your state is. And so when you're awake, there are different versions of your of state. So you have this, you can be calm and reflective. And if we've talked about this a little bit, that you're able to use this top part of your brain, the most unique and powerful part of your brain, the cortex. When you're out in the world and you're in an active alert state, you kind of shut down the reflective part of your brain and you activate sort of the process the moment part of your brain. And when you get under threat, you sort of shut down parts of your cortex and activate parts of your middle brain. And so the whole point is that depending upon your state, different systems are going to be in charge. Now, one of the things that, again, in general, as you get increasingly threatened, you use increasingly lower parts of your brain to control your functioning. And as we said earlier, if you think about the hierarchical organization of the brain and you get lower and lower and lower in the brain, you get to simpler and simpler and simpler systems. And by the time you get down to the lowest part of your brain, it's a little bit like a lizard's brain. So lizards are not very future-oriented. They don't think about the consequences of their behavior. They literally think about the moment. And so the more threatened you are, the more you're using these more primitive parts of your brain for problem solving and for behaving and so forth. And again, the key thing about this is that most of us are at baseline pretty well regulated. And when we have a moderate challenge, we have a moderate internal response. But the kids that we work with frequently have what we call a sensitized stress response. And what that means is they're overly reactive. So if they have a minor challenge, they'll have an overreaction. And so they can, in one moment, be able to use their cortex and think about the consequences of their behavior. And 2 minutes later, when they're walking down the hall and somebody bumps into them, that physical contact, which is processed by the lower part of the brain first, is reminiscent of physical contact when they were previously hurt. And their brain will act as if they're under threat and shut down their cortex, and they won't think about the consequences of their behavior. They'll just behave. And the behavior will be primitive and aggressive. And so they'll hit the kid who bumped into them in the hallway. And then the teacher will go, "What were you thinking?" And the reality is he wasn't thinking, he was reacting. And so one of the most important things about understanding state-dependent functioning and appreciating sequential processing of information is that if you put those two together, what you realize is that, gosh, a lot of these behaviors that these kids are doing are elicited. They're not planned. They don't come from the smart part of the brain. They come from the dumb part of the brain. And the smart part of the brain frequently hasn't even had a chance to process that moment because it's shut down because they're in the state of fear. And the combination that these kids have of an overly reactive stress response system and a whole set of, if you will, memories that are landmines that come from their previous abuse and neglect means that walking through the school day in a safe and predictable environment can still be filled with little incidents that will result in blowing up a landmine in this little boy's brain and having them act in a very inappropriate way and having them really not understand it. And certainly the adults around that child, they don't understand why he behaves that way. And so over time, misunderstanding emerges, and then attempts to solve the problem with a misunderstanding about what's going on leads to further misunderstanding. And you get this cascade of problems that are related to not understanding the neurobiology of trauma and not understanding the individual trauma history of the child.